I need a 3D printer that's always ready to print. That's just always set up, always ready to go, so that when I have an idea for something that I want to print, I spend the 5 or 10 minutes in CAD designing it, and then I can send it right off to the machine without having to hunt for slicer profiles, load filament, prepare the bed, or do whatever little naggy job to get the machine working. A good while back, I had a Mendel 90, not this one, a way older machine, just set up with Octoprint. It had ABS loaded in it, and I could do exactly that. You know, those were the good times. I could just send it something, and I could be mostly sure that it would print it just fine, and I could pick up my part 2 hours later. I was printing more useful stuff with that setup than I have ever since, so I want it back. And this one's going to be even better, with 4 different filaments loaded up at any time and ready to choose in the slicer, and with remote monitoring that can even alert you when a print starts going wrong. So let's check out what goes into my perfect, always ready printer setup. So of course, yes, this isn't totally perfect, but it's a fine balance that involves not making the system too complex from the start and then ending up with an unmaintainable mess that I'd again just end up not using. So let's start with the centerpiece, a Prusa Mark II, I think it's a Mark IIs, with the MMU upgrade. This is not the MMU II, the multi-material upgrade II that you'd use on the current Mark III and Mark IIis. This was their first dabble into multiplexing filament setups, and as such, it is not very good. Like with a lot of the other, you know, many in, one out hot end setups, I've had tons of issues with this one, not just when it comes to trying to print water-soluble PVA with PTG or PLA, which is naturally just a huge pain, but also just with trying to print multicolored parts that have 1 or 2 filament changes per layer. So it's not very good of a multi-material printer, but it's still got 4 fully featured extruders that you can choose from at any time. So the way I'm going to use it is basically like a pick and choose single material printer. Now compared to a regular Mark II, it is a true Bowden setup and not a direct drive one. So PTG will print a bit more stringy here, and flexibles are a big no-no. But overall, really just for, you know, an everyday printer, it's totally usable. After reactivating this printer from its extended hibernation, basically ever since I got it, there were a few things that I had to fix. They all revolve around getting reliable prints out. I had the issue that after a few layers, the extrusion would just stop, and when I came back to it, the extruder had almost entirely chewed through the filament. I did try to remove the multiplexer, because underneath this setup it's just a regular E3D V6 that you can plug a regular Bowden tube into, but that didn't fix it. So there must have been an issue with the extruder or the hot end itself, and as it turned out, it was both. First, the hot end, which was a clogged nozzle. Now, printing PVA tends to create really nasty charred deposits in the nozzle that are nearly impossible to clean out. So this nozzle was a goner. Instead of replacing it with another 0.4 millimeter one, I went for a slightly larger 0.5 millimeter one. Now, just by using a larger nozzle, you're not going to get faster prints, but it does lower the flow resistance of the hot end, which means, for me most of all, more reliable prints, but it's also more suitable for larger layer heights. The 0.35 millimeter layer height profile in Prusa Slicer works well with the stock 0.4 millimeter nozzle, but I'm thinking I might be able to just eke out a bit more effective speed without losing too much in detail reproduction. Where you're going to gain the most in speed is if you need a set shell thickness for your part. For example, if you need a, you know, 2 millimeter shell, you'd use about 5 perimeters for a 0.4 millimeter nozzle, but you only need 4 perimeters or 0.5 millimeter nozzle, roughly. Infill is also going to be faster for the same infill percentage, but you need to keep in mind that it's also going to be coarser, so it won't do as good of a job of supporting the top layers that rest on top of the infill. Anyways, the 0.5 millimeter nozzle works well. I'll show you in a second what I did to the slicer profiles to make it work smoothly in Prusa Slicer. The other thing was the extruders. I noticed that the Bontech drive gears were anything but lined up with the filament path. So I fixed that while I was at it. This isn't an MMU that I assembled. So, with the new nozzle and the extruder realigned, the Mark II SMMU1 was printing well. Time to move on to the next piece. Octoprint. Got it clamped down there. So this is basically a normal Octoprint setup. I've got this connected via wired Ethernet to avoid flaky Wi-Fi. In my case, I'm using Powerline because I don't have actual Ethernet wiring in the printer cave, but I still needed a way to at least monitor the print remotely, as in when I'm not in the same network as this printer and I'm out and about. Now, of course, it's generally not a good idea to leave a printer unattended, but I trust some of my machines enough to leave them running without me babysitting them constantly, at least for like the low risk prints. There are some good options listed on the Octoprint website for remote monitoring tools, and 3D Maker Noob has just posted a video where he explains his setup with Raise Cloud. I'll try to link that up here somewhere. But the two that I tried were Polar Cloud and the Spaghetti Detective. Both do remote monitoring, maybe in a slightly different way to each other. And the first one I tried was Polar Cloud. Now, I did not end up using them because obviously when you use a cloud monitoring service, you're going to need an account, and they only let you sign in with an existing Google, Facebook, or Microsoft account. And the only one of those that I really use is Google. Now, when you choose to log into Google, Polar Cloud requires you to give them access to your entire Google Drive content, which they say is for easy printing from Google Drive, in education settings particularly. But due to obvious reasons, I neither want to nor even legally can give them access to my Google Drive content. They say that, of course, you can create a new account with Google, for example, but managing and switching between my private and business accounts is already such a royal pain in my glutes, and I don't really want to add yet another Google account on top of that. So, Polar Cloud was out for me for the time being. Now, the Spaghetti Detective is actually not really known for remote printing. Their unique feature is actually an AI they trained to detect failing prints based on the webcam, you can obviously see that in frame there, that you've hooked up to your Octoprint setup. You can use that, but you don't have to. And even with their free plan, it's super convenient just to check in with your print every now and then and see if it's still doing well. Uploading G-codes and starting a print remotely is only supported in their paid plans. But I think for most of us, we'll be in the same location on the same network as our printer most of the time when we start a new print anyways. So, network setup. Octoprint plus the Spaghetti Detective, that's sorted. Next up, the slicer. Now, I like to use Prusa Slicer for many things, but since we are using an original Prusa machine, it makes extra sense here since it includes well-tuned profiles for the Mark IIs and its MMU1. There are a few tweaks though. So, Prusa Slicer gives you two options for running the MMU, either in single material mode or in true MMU mode. Now, it might sound intuitive to use single material mode, but that's actually the inferior choice in this case. So, single material will first of all disable any multi-material capabilities without a single part and also remove the prime tower, but it will ask you at the printer before every print which extruder you want to use. First of all, that would require me to walk over to the printer and select an extruder every time, and I'm lazy like that, but it would also introduce a possible issue where I can select an extruder with the wrong type of material loaded up. So instead, I want to use the full multi-material mode. You can choose which material is loaded up in each extruder. So what I want to have available is two types of PLA in extruder 1 and 2, and then a PETG in extruder 3, and finally an ABS in extruder 4. I'll set this up in Prusa Slicer, and then I'll load the matching materials on the printer itself. What you can do then is to load in a model, watch the prime tower disappear, and then just select the extruder, and with it, the material you want to use, right over here. So now the printer has all the info it needs to start the print right away, and there is no possibility of mixing up the materials. You choose it right there, and that's it. With the 0.5mm nozzle, there are a few things that are changed in the config to make use of that. Now, after I had already installed the 0.5mm nozzle, I remembered that there is actually a full config included in Prusa Slicer for a 0.6mm nozzle. So if you go for a nozzle swap, maybe go right to 0.6 instead of going with 0.5. But anyways, what I did was this. Starting with the 0.2mm layer height profile, in the Print Settings tab, I went to Advanced and added roughly 25% to the extrusion width, since, well, the 0.5 nozzle is, after all, 25% wider than the 0.41. I also updated the dependencies to correctly read 0.5 for the nozzle diameter so that the profiles wouldn't get mixed up, and then I saved it as a new profile with an obvious remark in the name. So now this profile should only show up whenever you've got a printer with a 0.5mm nozzle selected. So we still need to head over to the printer settings and change the nozzle diameter there to 0.5. Save as a new profile, done. So one last thing in the printer config that makes this so much more convenient to use is connecting Prusa Slicer to Octoprint. In Octoprint, you'll find your API key in the settings menu. Copy that, then in Prusa Slicer, select your Octoprint instance and paste the matching API key. When you head over to the Plater tab, you'll find this new Send G-code button down here, and with that, you can send your print right over to the printer without having to export G-code to your computer and then manually uploading it to Octoprint. It is just so convenient. So here's what the full printing process looks like. First, make sure your printer has its bed cleared from the last print. Then you grab your STL, pull it into Prusa Slicer, select your infill ratio, supports, etc., pick your material, hit send G-code, and because the printer is ready to print, you can even select start after upload, and it will start printing right away when the upload is done. The printer will do its warm-up, pick the right material, prime the nozzle, and once it's done printing, it will also unload the filament just enough to make room for any of the other filaments to start feeding. Rinse, repeat, rinse, repeat. One last thing I did was to drop the Mark II SMMU1 into my printer enclosure box. This is still open on the front, but it does provide a bit of a draft protection for printing ABS or PETG. It's also got lights built in to help the webcam out when it's dark. And there's this vibration damping mechanism in here, highly professional, which is just a stovetop cut out from my kitchen countertop to give it some weight and stability, and a piece of foam underneath to decouple the printer from the box and whatever surface it's sitting on. It's also got a filament rack on the back, but it's definitely not a bad idea to use a dry box if you want to keep PETG or ABS loaded up. With just a bunch of different PLA colors, it's totally fine having this open though. And yes, having filament on the back of your printer can be somewhat inconvenient, but of course this could be positioned wherever you want, even on the sides or on top. For loading it up, it's actually not bad, because all you need to do is to feed the filament through and then into the extruders, and that's all pretty well accessible, even when, you know, you're just reaching through the machine like that. So there you have it. That's going to be my printer setup for just getting stuff done. Of course, I'll still be reviewing, testing, and using other printers for reviews and stuff, but for now, this is going to be my productive setup that I can just always come back to and get stuff done efficiently. If you've got something like this set up too, share your tips in the comments below, especially if you've got like a solution to an issue you ran into or something that made your life easier. You never know, somebody else might be looking for the exact same thing. And a big thank you to all the patrons and YouTube members who are making this channel possible, even in times like these. Thank you all very, very much. If you want to join in as well, check out the links in the description, but even just watching the videos, leaving a like, and maybe even subscribing if you really like the videos, that would be awesome. Or share the video with your friends if you think that they could use the inspiration. In either case, thank you all for watching, keep on making, try and keep yourself and the people around you healthy, and I will see you in the next one.